Hey guys, welcome back to the ninth module of this data science course. So in the previous video, we discussed unsupervised machine learning and its working mechanism. That we also discussed that we use many algorithms like K-means or PCA in unsupervised learning. However, we did not discuss what are these algorithms and how do they work. Well, in today's module, we'll be deep diving into the K-means clustering algorithm. So in this module, we'll first understand the concept of clustering. Then we will look at the different types of clustering. After which, we will move on to K-means clustering, the main topic of our discussion today. And finally, we will understand the working mechanism of K-means algorithm. So before we explore K-means clustering, let us first understand what is clustering. So in simple words, clustering is a process of dividing the data set into groups of similar data points or features. So now let's look at the definition of clustering. So clustering is a process of dividing a data set into points where the data points in the same group are as similar as possible and the data points in the different groups are as dissimilar as possible. So now you might be thinking, why do we need clustering or where is it really applicable? Well, to tell you, we do use clustering in our day-to-day activities. For example, whenever you go to any supermarket, you will find that all vegetables are grouped in one row, fruits in another row, and other packaged foods in a different row. So they are clustered into different groups. Now this in turn will help you to fasten your shopping process. So another example would be the list of products on Amazon or Flipkart. So these online shopping apps recommend you the products based on your past history. So whatever you watched in your past, they recommend you the similar products or products related to it. So how do they recommend you the similar products? Well, again, the concept behind this is clustering. So, is there any criteria to apply clustering? So, mainly, these are the two things to be kept in mind. The interdistance between the two groups should be very large, and the intradistance between the members of the group should be very small. That means when you compare two different groups, they should be as dissimilar as possible, and when you compare two data points of a single group, they should be as similar as possible. So, now we'll discuss the different types of clustering. So there are three main types of clustering techniques, namely exclusive clustering, overlapping clustering, and hierarchical clustering. So let us start with exclusive clustering. So exclusive clustering is a hard clustering technique in which the data points exclusively belong to just one cluster. So you can see here that all the orange triangles belong to one group and all the purple triangles belong to another group. And both these clusters are entirely different from each other. So next we have overlapping clustering. So in this case, some of the data points belong to multiple groups. So as you can see over here, some of the orange and purple triangles belong to both the groups and are represented in green color. Then we have hierarchical clustering. So this algorithm starts with all the data points assigned to a cluster of their own. Then the two nearest clusters are merged into the same cluster. And in the end, this algorithm terminates when there is only a single cluster left. And to understand this, let's consider an example. So as you can see here, A and B and D and D are combined based on some similarities. And in the next step, the combination of A and B is quite similar to C and hence grouped in the one cluster. Similarly, in the next step, the combination of D and D is similar to F and hence grouped in one segment. And finally, in the fourth step, we see that the final tree includes all the clusters combined into one single cluster. Well, now that we know what is clustering and its different types, let us move on to K-means clustering, the main topic of our discussion today. So, K-means clustering is an algorithm whose main goal is to group similar data points into a cluster. And the number of groups or clusters are represented by K. So, K-means clustering runs on distance calculations, which uses Euclidean distance to calculate distance. And the formula for Euclidean distance is as shown on the screen. Now let's take an analogy and understand what K-means clustering is. So consider that you've been given a bunch of books and asked to arrange them in a library. So now how will you start segregating them? So let's say you meet a lecturer and come to know that all of these books belong to three subjects. So now you will just take three books at random. And those books will become a starting point for those three separate clusters. So again, you have to go through the massive initial group of books and look at each of the books to check under which cluster this book belongs to. Now you need to check all the characteristics of books like author, publication, and year to place them in one cluster. So technically, the starting book which you will choose will become a centroid. Now we will pick those books which are closer to the centroid and group them. And we repeat this step till we get the desired result. So now let's move on to the algorithm of k-means clustering. So if k is given, the k-means algorithm can be executed in the following steps. So in step 1, we partition the objects into k non-empty subsets. In step 2, we identify the cluster centroids of the current partition. In step 3, we assign each point to a specific cluster. In step 4, we compute the distances from each point and allot points to the cluster where the distance from the centroid is minimum. And in the last step, after reallotting the points, we find the centroid of the new cluster which is formed. And if it's too confusing, let's actually take an example to understand it in a better way. So consider that you started a new home delivery service for a supermarket and you want to open 3 delivery centers in the city. So first, you need to identify the possible challenges that you would face. So you need to identify the areas from where the orders are placed frequently. Then you need to identify the number of required delivery centers to cover in the specific area. And finally, you need to discover the locations for delivery centers to be established in order to keep the distance between supermarket and delivery points minimum. So now, answering these questions requires a lot of analysis and mathematics. However, clustering makes a life easy by solving out such real-life challenges. So let's see how. Now, consider these points as most probable locations in which the order is placed frequently. So now, these 3 points are considered as the delivery centers which cover the area more efficiently. That is, the distance from delivery centers to delivery point is least. So these would act as the centroids or the cluster centers. So now let us calculate the distance from each delivery location to our cluster centers or delivery centers. So the distance which is least will be colored in its color. That is, if the delivery center is near to orange cluster center, then the delivery location is colored in orange color. And similarly, we will do it for all delivery locations. So now we have all the delivery locations assigned to some cluster centers. So now we have all the delivery centers clustered into 3 clusters. So we'll go ahead and calculate the centroid of all the points lying within a particular cluster. So these centroids may come to be same as the current cluster centers or they may not. And if they are same, then it is an ideal scenario. So here the centroids come out to be different from the current cluster centers. So we will take these new cluster points as centroids and ignore the previous ones. Now again, we'll calculate the distance from each delivery location to the cluster center. So here again, we might find that some of the delivery locations are closer to the cluster centers. So we will just assign those delivery locations to the new cluster center and color them accordingly. So again, we have to find the new cluster centroid for all of the points. And if this comes out to be same as the previous cluster center, then it's fine. Else we have to repeat until the clusters converge. And since the cluster centers do not converge, we repeat the same process to find the new centroids. And we stop only when the cluster centers converge. So there is one more thing which we need to take care of, and it is called as distortion. So if the distortion is low, it means the clustering is good. So generally you would run k-means several times with different random initializations and choose the clustering with the lowest distortion. So distortion is calculated by using this formula given here. So this time we repeat the step keeping distortion in mind. So in this case, we'll just name the distance by using the distortion variable x. And now we will increase the number of k and check whether clusters improve or distort. So now let's check with the value of k to be 5. So we see that as the value of k increases, distortion decreases. And now if we decrease the value of k, let's say k equals 2, then the clusters would look like this and distortion increases. So we should choose the value of k such that even if we increase the value of k, the distortion remains constant. And this is called as the ideal value for k. And this can be identified by using the elbow method. So the point where distortion remains constant is considered as an ideal value of k. And this is how k-means clustering works. Now let me summarize the algorithm for you. So initially we need to find the number of clusters and centroid for a given data set. Then we identify the distance from the centroid and group them based on the minimum distance. And we repeat this step until we get the fixed centroid. So guys, this is all about the k-means algorithm. And this brings us to the end of the session. Thanks for attending and let's meet in the next class.